I was born under a bad sign with a blue moon in I've been playing games. We can try to hide it, it's all the same. I've been losing one day at a time.
Stop, everyone. Okay, just listen. Everything's not awesome, but that doesn't mean that it's hopeless and bleak. Everything's not awesome, but in my heart I believe. We can make things better if we stick together. If we stick together.
Together, 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 together Hello, everyone, and welcome to the Hollywood Critics Association Triviathon for COVID-19 relief. I am Scott Menzel, one of the many hosts for this evening. Thank you so much for joining us. We want to kind of take a little bit of time to go through the rules and expectations of tonight's game. So bear with me as this is the first time that I'm doing a trivia event. So there's a big expectations. We have a lot of surprises in store for everyone who's watching. I want to go through everything very, very quickly just so we can jump right into the fun stuff, but also to give a few minutes of time if anyone wants to join us. All right, so let's get into it. First and foremost, I am very well aware of what happened earlier today, which is a very sour note to start something like this on, but I would like to take a brief moment to honor the two incredible Hollywood legends that passed today, Mr. Fred Willard, and of course, Lynn Shelton. I was working on this all day. I saw the news and I was deeply saddened. So let's take just a moment of silence to honor them. Okay, thank you very much for that. You know, again, sad note to start this event on, but you know, those two, I mean, Lynn Shelton, what she did for independent film, and Fred Willard, what he did for comedy, and we have a whole round dedicated to comedy tonight. It only feels right that we honor them at the beginning of this. So you're going to be missed, and I'm very saddened about both of their passing. So now jumping into the game, real quick, a shout out to Zachary Marsh and also our member, Nestor Bentancor, Mr. Presidente. He is the one who did all the graphics for this trivia event, all the posts that you've seen on Facebook and Twitter and Instagram. Nestor did that. The video content that's going to be shared throughout the night, most of that was actually done by Zachary Marsh. So thank you very much for that. Now to kind of get to the people behind the scenes, because there's a lot of people working behind the scenes to make this thing work. And we have, of course, my wife and co-founder of the organization, Ashley Menzel. She is going to be our scorekeeper tonight. We have Lupe Rodriguez Haas, and she's going to be in the YouTube chat. She's going to be the moderator. We have Mark Passis, who's going to be on the Twitch chat. And we have Dimitri Panos doing social media. And you're going to have seven other hosts besides myself, but we're going to do those introductions. You probably know who they are if you've seen some of the images going around. So we're going to talk. Well, they'll talk and introduce themselves as they come in. Eight rounds of trivia, really quick, really key rules. If you're filling out the form, which is the answer sheet, I will have someone post it again into both of the YouTube feed and also the Twitch feed. You will be able to go on there, and as each round is opened, you will be able to click on it and go in there and get your answers submitted. Take a little bit of time. If you're not sure, you have a little bit of time to submit your answer. So think about it. You might want to take a little bit of notes because it's going to go by really quick. Unlike a lot of like shows that you may watch on YouTube, when you play trivia, if you're really involved with it, it goes by really, really quick. So, be prepared for that. So take notes. The big thing is this whole thing is being done for charity, and you know, we need to kind of raise some funds here for seven of the charities that we're going to be talking about throughout the night. And I'm going to let everyone introduce those as it comes, you know, as they come up. But if you want to donate, I need to talk about this. This is very, very important. So there's two ways to donate for this event. There is Vimeo, which you can go right here. This is right which you can send the Vimeo funds for. Or if you want to do PayPal, you can do PayPal, which is this is the link for the PayPal. So I'm going to leave the PayPal on a little bit longer because it's a URL. The Venmo is just Hollywood Critics. All right. So you want to donate, you want to be nice. That's great. I would love if you can donate and share because the organizations that we are celebrating tonight, all seven of them have been doing incredible things. But it's very important that you know the rules to how to donate. So obviously, you know the two ways to donate, but what is every donation going to get you? What are we expecting for donations? Again, this is a free event. If you don't have money, if you're suffering from COVID-19 and the stress, you're out of work, don't worry about it. I understand like not everyone's in the same boat. So please, if you don't have funds, don't worry about it. Just have fun. Enjoy yourself. This is a night of entertainment. It's going to be fun. But if you do have a little bit of money to spare, we're going to do a huge, huge, huge raffle at the end of the night. And that's going to start right now. So how that works is for every $5 that you donate, you will get one entry into the big raffle at the end of the night. Now, if you donate $25, you'll get five entries, so on and so forth. So the more you donate, the more chances you have to win. Now, we have a lot of stuff to give away. I'm not going to be able to pull everything up here, but I'll show you a few things. So if you were here right at the beginning of the show, you know that we played a song from Top Gun. So I felt like it was only necessary to give away a copy of Top Gun on Blu-ray. So that'll be one of the prizes for the raffle. You will also get a Google Mini Nest. The company that I work for, who was actually very kind to donate most people who are on this event tonight with microphones, the company is called TVPS. They will actually be donating a microphone as well, this one right here, to the winner of the raffle. So you will get that in the mail as well. If you want to look at what the microphone actually looks like out of the box, this is kind of what it is. It's a USB, USB microphone. And, we also have this Captain Marvel doll. And there's a huge package here and there's something that I can show you, but we have this huge, huge package. I'm not going to open it, but Pat Shin, my buddy Pat Shin over who used to be at Sony, he now works at HBO Max, sent us this huge care package. If you're a fan of HBO, there's a lot of goodies inside here. So you'll be getting this, and this is going to be a very heavy item to ship. That's that. And then one other item, which I don't actually have a video for because one of our members is actually donating it. There is going to be a Mulan prize pack. I believe it's like a shirt, a book, and a couple other things. So all that is included. Plus, our organization is also going to throw in a $50 Amazon gift card. So if you really added up all that stuff, easily $200-$300 worth of stuff. So $5 will get you one raffle ticket. Very important that you support and help out these organizations if you have the funds, if you have that money available. All right. So real quick, just rules. Answer sheet, make sure if you're working with a team, put the team name, designate a team captain and put the team name on there. Make sure it's spelled the exact same way every single time. The same with the email address. Make sure that all that stuff is spelled correctly through every single round, because there is prizes, which will be announced tomorrow for those who come in the top three of this trivia game overall. And this is most important. I think it's self-explanatory at this point. I know you're watching this on a computer, but that is not okay. It is not okay to Google the answers. So do not Google the answers. It's supposed to be a fun trivia event. It's supposed to test your knowledge. Instead, open a bottle of wine, have a beer, whatever you want to do, have a Pepsi, have a Coke, whatever you drink, you know, enjoy that. Just relax, have fun. Those are the rules. And let's get on with the show. So I want to start off with our first round, which I have to pull up right now. And our first round begins now.
Ladies and gentlemen, can I please have your attention?
Make them laugh, make them laugh, make them laugh.
All right. So the first category based on that is all about comedy movies and TV shows. And I will go through and read the questions, or there might be a surprise pop-up video appearance by some celebrities. So we'll see. The first question to kick it off is a question from myself. This is the question. If you can see it on the screen, I will also read it. Keep in mind, if anyone who knows me, I do stumble a little bit every once in a while. So I apologize. It's just kind of like my DNA. It happens all the time. I do apologize. All right. Which fictional television character had his own Comedy Central series and a spin-off film that focused on a murder that occurred at the Toronto International Film Festival? Once again, that question is, which fictional television character had his own Comedy Central series and a spin-off film that focused on a murder that occurred at the Toronto International Film Festival? If you need a hint for this, the character was created by a Canadian comedian. All right, I'll give you a few minutes there. All right, question number two. Oh my God, look at this. We have a surprise guest for question number two.
Hi, I'm McKenna Grace, and my question is, in the making of the original Ghostbusters film, what substance was used to create the marshmallow goop that fell on everyone after the Stay Puffed Marshmallow Man got destroyed?
Once again, I will play that question for you.
Hi, I'm McKenna Grace, and my question is, in the making of the original Ghostbusters film, what substance was used to create the marshmallow goop that fell on everyone after the Stay Puffed Marshmallow Man got destroyed?
And just in case you could not hear that video, here is the slide with the question. All right. And McKenna was so kind that she actually sent off a bonus question. So if you see this on the answer sheet, it says two, and then there should be another slot. I think it's 2A or 2B. You just put that the second answer to this question in that spot online. Here is the second part of McKenna's question.
Okay, so here's a little bonus trivia that I figured out all by myself over quarantine. While I was watching Ace Ventura Pet Detective, I kept thinking that the woman who was playing Mrs. Finkel seemed very familiar. It was kind of odd, so I decided to IMDb her, and as it turns out, the woman who played Mrs. Finkel played the library ghost in the original Ghostbusters, which is kind of random, two different characters, but I thought that that was really cool. I hope that you guys thought it was cool too.
And there is the question one more time. Which actress plays the librarian in Ghostbusters and also stars in Ace Ventura, Pet Detective? All right, question number three. Who is the character Jeff Lebowski, aka the Dude, from The Big Lebowski based on? Once again, who is the character Jeff Lebowski, aka the Dude from The Big Lebowski, based on? All right. Question number four. Which Hulu original series featured John Cho, Seth Meyers, John Mulaney, and John Benjamin Hickley as love interests for one of the show's protagonists? Which Hulu original series featured John Cho, Seth Meyers, John Mulaney, and John Benjamin Hickey as love interests for one of the show's protagonists? I honestly have never seen an episode of this show, so I would never get this question. All right. Next question. Which famous comedian slash actor is Slimer from Ghostbusters loosely based? Which famous comedian slash actor is Slimer from Ghostbusters loosely based? All right, and next question.
Okay, Glenn Powell and I were in a Netflix romantic comedy called Set It Up. However, this was not the first film that we were in together. What is the name of the other film?
Here's the question one more time on the screen. And I'm going to have Zoe say it one more time.
Okay. Glenn Powell and I were in a Netflix romantic comedy called Set It Up. However, this was not the first film that we were in together. What is the name of the other film?
Okay, I'll leave that on screen for just a few more minutes. All right, next question. In Fletch, which of the following names is not an alias used by the title character? Arnold Babar, Richard M. Nixon, Harry S. Truman, John Coxstone. Once again, in Fletch, which of the following names is not used as an alias by the title character? Arnold Babar, Richard M. Nixon, Harry S. Truman, or John Coxstone? And clearly the answer for the multiple choice one, you can just put the letter, or you can actually type out the full answer. Totally up to you. All right. Next question. In the first Sex and the City movie, what is the first clothing item Carrie and Big put into their newly remodeled closet? In the first Sex and the City movie, what is the first clothing item Carrie and Big put in their newly remodeled closet? All right, next question. Before they played the McAllister parents in the 1990 Christmas classic Home Alone, what movie did Catherine O'Hara and John Hurd both appear in prior? Before they played the McAllister parents in the 1990 Christmas classic Home Alone, what movie did Catherine O'Hara and John Hurd both appear in? I think this is a very hard question. And next one. All right. Which three films starring Jim Carrey were directed by Tom Shadyac? Which three films starring Jim Carrey were directed by Tom Shadyac? Alrighty, and for our final question of this round, I also feel bad because there was news that came out about this person's movie today. And I'm sending him good thoughts, and I know it's going to be great. So, but I'm sad to hear the news. But here you go. Here is your final question of the round.
Hey there, Scott and everybody at the Hollywood Critics Association. I'm Edgar Wright. I'm speaking from London. And as you can see, my hair now looks like Rolf from The Muppet Show. So that's exciting. But I am here today with something else exciting, a trivia question for you. And it's quite a tough one. So scribble this down. So in my so-called Cornetto trilogy, there are 6 actors that appear in all 3 movies with speaking parts. So in Shaun of the Dead, Hot Fuzz, and The World's End, there are 6 actors that are in all 3 movies and have a speaking part. Actors or actresses. So who are those 6 performers who are in all 3 movies and have a speaking part? And I guess I'll be back with the answer shortly. Good luck.
All right. There is the shortened version of the question on screen, but who doesn't like hearing Edgar Wright talk? So I'm going to definitely be playing that clip again.
Okay. Here's the answer.
Wrong on my part. I almost showed you the answer earlier.
Hey there, Scott and everybody at the Hollywood Critics Association. I'm Edgar Wright. I'm speaking from London. And as you can see, my hair now looks like Rolf from The Muppet Show. So that's exciting. But I am here today with something else exciting, a trivia question for you. And it's quite a tough one. So scribble this down. So in my so-called Cornetto trilogy, there are 6 actors that appear in all 3 movies with speaking parts. So in Shaun of the Dead, Hot Fuzz, and The World's End, there are 6 actors that are in all 3 movies and have a speaking part. Actors or actresses. So who are those 6 performers who are in all 3 movies and have a speaking part? And I guess I'll be back with the answer shortly. Good luck.
All right. So here's the question one more time on screen. I know that's a toughie. You thought I was going to give you the answers early. I'm not giving you the answer early. You got to wait. All right. So real quick, I will just put the questions back on screen, probably about like 10 seconds each, starting with the first question. So if you didn't submit your sheets yet, you can go through them. And then there's going to be like a 60-second timer counting down, and we will then close out the round and begin revealing the answers. So, okay, going back to the first question, here we go. Second question. Bonus question. All right. Almost to the last question. Second to last question there. And once again, the final question. All right, so that is round one in terms of the question. We will put up a timer for about 60 seconds because there is a delay, a little bit of a delay. And what we'll do then is at the end of that, the round will be closed. And then once the round is closed, we will announce the answers to that round, and then I will say bye-bye, and someone else will come on and take over, and the next person in line is Lauren Huff. So she'll be 100% more entertaining than me. She will 100% be, as she shakes her head in the waiting room. All right, guys, here we go. Countdown, 60 seconds until it closes. And just like that, the round is over. If you didn't submit your answers, you're too late. You missed out on round number one. Tisk, tisk, tisk. Tisk, tisk, tisk. All right, I'm just waiting for confirmation. Oh, and Ashley's on top of it. It's like she's a pro or something. Round one is officially closed. So let's go through and do the fun part and the reason everyone is here to find out the answers. All right. So I'm going to put the questions back on the screen and then I have to scroll down and show you the answer. So real quick, we're going to go through this. Question one, which fictional television character had his own Comedy Central series and a spinoff film that focused on a murder that occurred at the Toronto International Film Festival? All right. So the answer to this question is Jiminy Glick. And I am going to show you. But now it will not come up, which is problematic. So I may just have to read off the answers, which is unfortunate because I have them hit here, but for some reason it does not show. Hold on one sec. Okay, so I am going to have to, unfortunately, read off the answers because the program does not allow me to say what the answers are unless I take myself out of the stream. So I'm going to read off the answers. So the first answer is Jiminy Glick. Congratulations if you got that correct. All right. In the making of the original Ghostbusters, what substance was used to create the marshmallow goop that fell on everyone after the Stay Puft Marshmallow Man was destroyed? All right.
Okay, time's up. If you guessed shaving cream, then you are absolutely correct.
All right, thank you, McKenna. All right, and then for the next question, which actress plays the librarian in Ghostbusters and also stars in Ace Ventura, Pet Detective? The answer to that question is... Okay, so I'm going to have to work really hard during the next round to get these files uploaded back to people because every single one I have to click off and click on. So this is my bad on this. I do apologize. Technical difficulties, first time we've ever did a show like this. So I do apologize for that. So luckily, I have every single one of these answers into a folder, so I will just put the questions on the screen, and then I will open the answers on my desktop and read them from there. So give me one second. I really apologize about this. So for the next question, who is the character Jeff Lebowski, aka the dude from The Big Lebowski, based on? The answer to that is Jeff Dowd. Which Hulu original series featured John Cho, Seth Meyers, John Mulaney, John Benjamin Hickey as love interest for the show's protagonist? The answer to that is Difficult People. Which famous comedian slash actor is Slimer from the Ghostbusters loosely based on? John Belushi. Glenn Powell and I starred in the Netflix romantic comedy Set It Up. However, this was not their first film. What was the name of their first film? It was Everybody Wants Some. In Fletch, which of the following names is not an alias used by the title character? The answer to that is Richard M. Nixon. In the first Sex and the City movie, what is the first clothing item Carrie and Big put into their newly remodeled closet? I am going to butcher the name of this because I have no idea how to pronounce it. Manlow pumps. All right. Next question. Before they played the McAllister parents in Home Alone, what movie did Catherine O'Hara and John Hurt both appear in? And the answer to that one is After Hours. Which three films starring Jim Carrey were directed by Tom Shadak? And the answer to that one is Ace Ventura, Pet Detective, Liar Liar, and Bruce Almighty. And Edgar's going to answer his own question for the last one, but here's the question one more time. In the Cornetto trilogy, there are six actors or actresses who appear in all three films with speaking roles. Name all six.
Okay, here's the answer. The actors or actresses that appear in Shaun of the Dead, Hot Fuzz, and The World's End are as follows. Simon Pegg, obviously. Nick Frost, obviously. Martin Freeman, Rafe Spall, Bill Nighy, and Julia Deakin. Those are the six actors. If any of you got all six, you're as big a nerd as I am. Okay. Be safe. Speak to you soon.
Alrighty. So that was round number one. I am going to, as Lauren is doing her introductions, I will not give the rest of the panelists a heart attack. I will be uploading the images as they come in. So the rest of the game will be very smooth. We'll be able to show the question, show the answer. They won't have to read it. I'm going to take that, do that one by one as they're on. So let's jump over to Lauren Huff, who will be taking it away. Lauren Huff, welcome to the Triviathon.
Hi, guys. Thanks, Scott. As Scott said, my name is Lauren Huff, and I am a board member with the Hollywood Critics Association. And in my day job, I am a writer for Entertainment Weekly. Before we get started with my round, which will be awards, which is very on brand for me, if you know me, I want to remind everybody that, again, this is all for a great cause, or several great causes, actually. One that I would like to talk about is the ASPCA, which, for those of you who don't know, is the American Society for the Prevention of Cruelty to Animals. And they work to basically rescue animals from abuse, pass humane laws, share resources with shelters nationwide, all of that good stuff. So if you, like me, have a soft spot in your heart for our furry friends, I hope that you'll consider donating to them. Again, the PayPal link should be somewhere in the chat. We've also tweeted it out. I know it's probably on our other social media forums as well. And our Venmo is at Hollywood Critics. You can also go to ASPCA.org and donate that way. So that's the organization I wanted to talk to you guys about. So without further ado, let's get into the second round, which is awards. So we will be talking about Oscar and the Emmys a little bit. Let's get that started. All right, the first question is my own. Yay. What are the three animated feature films that have been nominated for Best Picture? And again, that question is, what are the three animated feature films that have been nominated for Best Picture? And that was question number one. And again, everybody, please remember to be using the same name and email in your forms that you did for the first round. And please continue to do that throughout the next several rounds as well. All right, question number two. Robin Williams was nominated for an Emmy for a heartbreaking guest starring role in the second season premiere of what trendsetting 90s cop show? And again, that question is, Robin Williams was nominated for an Emmy for a heartbreaking guest starring role in the second season premiere of what trendsetting 90s cop show? And I am seeing in the chat that the team name section has been taken out of the answer sheet. So don't worry about that. Just make sure your email is correct and you use the same one each time. All right, question number three. Meryl Streep, oh, we love Meryl, has been nominated for a total of 21 Oscars because she is a legend. How many of those were supporting nominations? Good question, Jazz. All right, Meryl Streep has been nominated for a total of 21 Oscars. How many of those were supporting nominations? All right, question number 5, I believe. Question number 4. Yes, question number 4. Who in Oscar history has the most acting nominations with 0 wins? Who in Oscar history has the most acting nominations with 0 wins? Question number 5. In 1956, 2 African-American actors were nominated for a Primetime Emmy Award for the first time ever. Who were those actors? In 1956, 2 African-American actors were nominated for a Primetime Emmy Award for the first time ever. Who were those 2 actors? Alrighty, this next question is question number 6, and it is, which of the following actors did not win 2 competitive acting Oscars during the 1970s? We're using film years here, not the ceremony years, for those of you who are super technical. A, Jane Fonda, B, Maggie Smith, C, Jason Robards, D, Glenda Jackson. And again, that question is, which of the following actors did not win 2 competitive acting Oscars during the 1970s? Jane Fonda, Maggie Smith, Jason Robards, or Glenda Jackson? And again, that was question number 6. Question number 7. Before he was John McClane in Die Hard, Bruce Willis was a 2-time Emmy-winning actor on what TV series? Before he was John McClane in Die Hard, Bruce Willis was a 2-time Emmy-winning actor on what TV series? And that is question number 7. Question number 8. Although she was only on screen for 6 minutes, Dame Judi Dench won an Academy Award for Best Supporting Actress for her role in which movie? And again, although she was only on screen for 6 minutes, Dame Judi Dench won an Academy Award for Best Supporting Actress for her role in which movie? And that was question number 8. Question 9. What was the first film directed by a woman to earn an Academy Award in any category? Again, what was the first film directed by a woman to earn an Academy Award nomination in any category?
Hi, my name is Ruth Carter, and I have a trivia question for you. Which costume designer won the most Oscars?
All right, and that was our final question for the round, question number 10. If you did not hear the legend Ruth E. Carter herself, she asked which costume designer won the most Oscars. All right, one more time, we're gonna go through all of the questions, and then you will have, again, a countdown to submit all of them, and then we will go through the answers. All right, question number 1. What are the 3 animated feature films that have been nominated for Best Picture? Question 2. Robin Williams was nominated for an Emmy for a heartbreaking guest starring role in the 2nd season premiere of what trendsetting 90s cop show? Question 3. Meryl Streep has been nominated for a total of 21 Oscars. How many of those were supporting nominations? Question 4. Who in Oscar history has the most acting nominations with 0 wins? Question 5. In 1956, 2 African-American actors were nominated for a Primetime Emmy Award for the first time ever. Who were those actors? Question number 6. Which of the following actors did not win 2 competitive acting Oscars during the 1970s? A. Jane Fonda. B. Maggie Smith. C. Jason Robards. D. Glenda Jackson. Question 7. Before he was John McClane in Die Hard, Bruce Willis was a 2-time Emmy-winning actor on what television series? Question 8. Although she was only on screen for 6 minutes, Dame Judi Dench won an Academy Award for Best Supporting Actress for her role in which movie? Question 9. What was the first film directed by a woman to earn an Academy Award nomination in any category? And the last question. Which costume designer won the most Oscars? All right. So we're going to give you some time to submit all of those answers. I guess good luck. We're going to put up that really intense timer again, I think, I hope. So. All right, that is it. Round 2 has been closed, so I hope you got in all of your answers. All right, I guess now is the moment of truth. Let's see how you guys did. Oh, I think you're muted, Scott.
All right, so I'm going to step in here real quick, let you know that I was able to upload all of the answers during that round. The only one that I did not do was your question, so but you know the answer to it, so you can say it. So I'll pull the question back on the screen, and I'll see everyone in a little bit.
Okay, great. Thanks, Scott. All right. So question number 1, which was my question, is what are the 3 animated feature films that have been nominated for Best Picture? That answer is Beauty and the Beast, Up, and Toy Story 3. So good job if you guys got that. All right, question number 2. Robin Williams was nominated for an Emmy for a heartbreaking guest starring role in the 2nd season premiere of what trendsetting 90s cop show? The answer, Homicide, Life on the Street. All right, question 3. Meryl Streep has been nominated for a total of 21 Oscars. How many of those were supporting nominations? 4. Good job, Meryl. Who in Oscar history has the most acting nominations with 0 wins? And that is Peter O'Toole with 8 nominations. In 1956, 2 African-American actors were nominated for a Primetime Emmy Award for the first time ever. Who were those actors? The answer is Harry Belafonte and Sammy Davis Jr. All right. Which of the following actors did not win two competitive acting Oscars during the 1970s? And that answer is, drumroll, B, Maggie Smith. All right. Before he was John McClane in Die Hard, Bruce Willis was a two-time Emmy-winning actor on what TV series? Moonlighting. And although she was only on screen for 6 minutes, Dame Judi Dench won an Academy Award for Best Supporting Actress for her role in which movie? Shakespeare in Love. All right. What was the first film directed by a woman to earn an Academy Award nomination in any category? The answer is Sarah and Son, 1930, directed by Dorothea Arzner. The film was nominated for one Academy Award for Best Actress for Ruth Chatterton.
Hi, my name is Ruth Carter, and I have a trivia question for you. Which costume designer won the most Oscars?
Edith Head, not Ruthie Carter. Although hopefully someday she will have that honor. All right, guys, that is all for me for my round. I hope you guys enjoyed. I know I love me some awards trivia. Next up, we have Jamie Philbrick, who will be doing the superhero round. Thanks for joining.
All right, thanks, Lauren.
Thanks, Jamie.
Thank you so much. My name is Jamie Philbrick, and I'm a senior staff writer and producer at MTime, and also an HCA board member. And welcome to round three, which is Superheroes Are Us. Obviously, we're going to be dealing with questions in this category that are comic books, superhero related, television, and film. In this category, we're going to be playing for UNICEF, which of course is United Nations Children's Fund. That's a great charity. They're doing a lot of fantastic work right now during the pandemic. So please donate if you can. And we want to remind you to use notes, totally use notes. We're going to be throwing a lot of questions at you in this round. So use notes as you can. And don't forget to put your email on your submissions. So without any further ado, let's go.
Showtime.
All right, first question. What song is Baby Groot dancing to in the opening credits of Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 2? So question number one, what song is Baby Groot dancing to in the opening credits of Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 2? Question number two, who was the first actor to play Superman on television or in film? Who was the first actor to play Superman on television or in a film? Question number two. Question number three, in what film did Black Widow make her first appearance in the MCU? Question number three, in what film did Black Widow make her first appearance in the MCU? Question number four, name the actor who played Tom Curry, Arthur Curry's father, in Warner Brothers' Aquaman. Question number four, name the actor who played Tom Curry, Arthur Curry's father, in Warner Brothers' Aquaman. Question number five, who was originally cast to play the role of Vicki Vale in Tim Burton's Batman, but was replaced by Kim Basinger after a horse riding incident? Very famous Hollywood story. Question number five, who was originally cast to play the role of Vicki Vale in Tim Burton's Batman, but was replaced by Kim Basinger after a horse riding incident? Question number six, in the end credits sequence of The Avengers, what is the restaurant grade of the shawarma restaurant they are sitting in? So you know restaurants have a letter grade. In the end credit sequence of The Avengers, what is the restaurant grade of the shawarma restaurant that the Avengers are sitting in? Question number 7. Who plays Breacher on the CW series The Flash? Who plays the character Breacher on the CW series The Flash? And question number 8. What popular superhero film had to have its entire marketing campaign restructured due to the September 11th attacks? So question number 8, what popular superhero film had to have its entire marketing campaign restructured due to the September 11th attacks? All right, so remember to write your email on your submissions, and we're going to give you the questions again so you have another couple of minutes to think about it. So here we go one more time with the questions. Question number 1, what song is Baby Groot dancing to in the opening credits of Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 2? Question number 2, who was the first actor to play Superman on television or in a film? Question number 3, in what film did Black Widow make her first appearance in the MCU? Question number 4, name the actor who played Tom Curry, Arthur Curry's father, in Warner Brothers' Aquaman. Question number 5, who was originally cast to play the role of Vicki Vale in Tim Burton's Batman, but was replaced by Kim Basinger after a horse riding incident? Question number 6, in the end credits sequence of The Avengers, what is the restaurant grade of the shawarma restaurant that the Avengers are sitting in? Question number 7, who was originally cast to play the role of Vicki Vale in Tim Burton's Batman, but was replaced by Kim Basinger after a horse riding accident? I think that might be the wrong question. Let's see. Question number 7. Okay, question number 6, in the end credit sequence of The Avengers, what is the restaurant grade of the shawarma restaurant they are sitting in? Let's go to question number 7. Who plays Breacher on the CW series The Flash? And question number 8, what popular superhero film had to have its entire marketing campaign restructured due to the September 11th attacks? All right, those are some wild, good questions we had there. So we're going to remind you to be sure to put your email in your submissions. We're going to give you a 60-second timer here, and when we come back, I'll give you the answers to the questions. All right, that was some dramatic music. Here we go. I think we are round 3 is closed. I've just been told that. And let's go to the answers. Question number 1. What song is Baby Groot dancing to in the opening credits of Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 2? And the answer is Mr. Blue Sky by Electric Light Orchestra, otherwise known as Jeff Lynne's ELO. Question number 2, who was the first actor to play Superman on television or in a film? And the answer is Kirk Alen. Fun fact, Mr. Alen was also the actor that played General Sam Lane in Richard Donner's original Superman movie. Question number 3, in what film did Black see you?
You're going to have to repeat that because your mic got screwed up.
Okay. In what film did Black Widow make her first appearance in the MCU? And the answer is Iron Man 2. Question number 4. Name the actor who played Tom Curry, Arthur Curry's father, in Warner Brothers' Aquaman. The answer is Amora Morrison. Fun fact, he's also the actor that played Jango Fett and was recently announced to be playing Boba Fett in The Mandalorian Season 2. Question number 5. Who was originally cast to play the role of Vicki Vale in Tim Burton's Batman, but was replaced by Kim Basinger after a horse riding incident? And the answer is Sean Young. Sean Young, who also famously petitioned to play Catwoman in Batman Returns, but lost the role to Michelle Pfeiffer. Question number 6. In the end credits sequence of The Avengers, what is the restaurant grade of the shawarma restaurant they are sitting in? And the answer is a grade A. That's a great restaurant to eat at. Question number 7. Who plays Breacher on the CW series The Flash? And the answer is the great actor Danny Trejo. And our final question, number 8, what popular superhero film had its entire marketing September 11th attacks? And the answer is Sam Raimi's Spider-Man. I believe they had to take out the Twin Towers, which were in the trailer. They had to take that out of the film. So those are the answers. Thank you so much for playing this round. I am now going to pass it off for round 4 to the terrific Alicia Malone.
Oh, stop, Jamie. Thank you so much, and good work on your quarantine beard. It's very impressive. I'm Alicia Malone, and I'm a host on Turner Classic Movies, as well as a contributor to the Criterion Channel's series Adventures in Movie Going. And I'm excited because my round is a little bit special. We have a social media raffle that we'll be running throughout this round, and it's really simple to enter. All you need to do is go over to Twitter and tweet at HCA Critics and tell us, what was the last film you saw inside a theater before the world shut down? So again, go over to HCA Critics on Twitter, write to us and say, what was the last film you saw in a theater before the world shut down? We're going to be picking the winner at random, and you have this whole round to enter. So make sure you do that because the prizes are amazing. We have a $25 Amazon gift card and a 3-month subscription to the Criterion Channel, which I've been watching so much of here in quarantine. So before I get into my round, let me tell you about the charity that I am representing. It is MPTF, which is the Television Fund. And it is really special because it was set up in 1921 by Charlie Chaplin, D.W. Griffith, Douglas Fairbanks, and Mary Pickford to help artists in Hollywood who were struggling and were in need. And then later it was expanded also to include television and not just films. So right now they have a special COVID-19 emergency relief fund. So if you have money to give and you'd like to make a donation, you can do that through our Venmo and PayPal links. We will pass it on to the MPTF. And if you want to you know, contribute to them specifically, you can also make that note in your transaction for us. Otherwise, we'll just spread out the donations very easily and equally amongst everyone. Okay, so my round is number four, the classics. Let's get into it.
All right, Mr. DeMille, I'm ready for my close-up.
Here we go. Question number one. For which film did Rita Hayworth have her trademark red hair cut short and dyed blonde? Was it A, The Strawberry Blonde, B, The Lady from Shanghai, C, Pal Joey, or D, Covergirl? I'll ask that again. For which film did Rita Hayworth have her trademark red hair cut short and dyed blonde? Was it A, The Strawberry Blonde, B, The Lady from Shanghai, C, Pal Joey, or D, Covergirl? Question number two. This Munster's star was also the star of another classic television show where he played a police officer. Who is the actor and what is the name of the show? Again, this Munster's star was also the star of another classic television show where he played a police officer. Who is the actor and what is the name of the show? Question three, who was the first woman to speak in a horror film and in what movie? Once more, question three, who was the first woman to speak in a horror film and in what movie? Question four, in what classic 1942 film is the line, "Don't let's ask for the moon, we have the stars"? It's a great line. Again, in what classic 1942 film do we hear the line, "Don't let's ask for the moon, we have the stars"? Question five. Inspector Jacques Clouseau was played by four different actors in the Pink Panther films. Name all four actors who played the iconic character. Again, Inspector Jacques Clouseau was portrayed by four different actors in the Pink Panther films. Name all four actors who played the iconic character.
What was the first feature-length animated movie ever released? Was it A, Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs, B, Bambi, C, Cinderella, or D, Pinocchio?
Yes, that was the great Australian actress Geraldine Viswanathan, and her question was, what was the first feature-length animated film ever released? Was it A, Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs, B, Bambi, C, Cinderella, or D, Pinocchio? Okay, question number seven. Which well-known television actress gave birth in real life on the same day as her TV character? Once more, which well-known television actress gave birth in real life on the same day as her television character? Question eight. Casablanca is based on an unproduced stage play written by Murray Burnett and Joan Allison. What is the name of that stage play? Casablanca is based on an unproduced stage play written by Murray Burnett and Joan Allison. What was the name of that stage play? Question 9. Jimmy Stewart starred in 4 films directed by Alfred Hitchcock. In which one of those 4 films did Stewart play a doctor? Was it A, The Man Who Knew Too Much, B, Rope, C, Vertigo, or D, Rear Window? Again, question number 9. Jimmy Stewart starred in 4 films directed by Alfred Hitchcock. In which one of those 4 films did Stewart play a doctor? Was it A, The Man Who Knew Too Much, B, Rope, C, Vertigo, or D, Rear Window? And question 10, the final question for this round. In Butch Cassidy and the Sundance Kid, what South American country do the title actors travel to towards the end of the movie? One more time. In Butch Cassidy and the Sundance Kid, what South American country do the title characters travel to towards the end of the movie? A few tricky ones in there. We'll go through all the questions one more time. Number 1, which film did Rita Hayworth have her trademark red hair cut short, dyed blonde? Was it A, The Strawberry Blonde, B, The Lady from Shanghai, C, Pal Joey, or D, Covergirl? Question 2, this Munster's star was also the star of another classic television show where he played a police officer. Who is the actor and what is the name of the show? Question 3, who was the first woman to speak in a horror film and in what movie? Question 4, in what classic 1942 film do we hear the line, "Don't let's ask for the moon, we have the stars"? Number 5, Inspector Jacques Clouseau was portrayed by 4 different characters in the Pink Panther films. Name all 4 actors who played the iconic character. Number 6 was thanks to Geraldine Viswanathan, and she says, what was the first feature-length animated film ever released? A, Snow White and the 7 Dwarves, B, Bambi, C, Cinderella, or D, Pinocchio? Question 7, which well-known television actress gave birth in real life on the same day as her TV character? Question 8, Casablanca is based on an unproduced stage play written by Murray Burnett and Joan Allison. What was the name of that stage play? Number 9, Jimmy Stewart starred in 4 films directed by Alfred Hitchcock. In which one of those 4 films did Stewart play a doctor? A, The Man Who Knew Too Much, B, Rope, C, Vertigo, D, Rear Window. And question number 10, in Butch Cassidy and the Sundance Kid, what South American country do the title characters travel to towards the end of the movie? Good luck to everyone taking part, and just a reminder to use the same email address that you've been using for all the rounds. And my charity is MPTF, the Motion Picture and Television Fund. Make sure you donate if you can to our Venmo and PayPal accounts, and we will pass on those funds. And don't forget to enter in our little social media raffle, because that will be ending at the conclusion of this round. Go to Twitter at HCA Critics and tell us what was the last movie you watched in the theater, you know, before everything shut down. All right, let's give you some thinking time. Start the very dramatic clock. round four is now closed, as is also our social media raffle. Good luck to everyone who've entered both of those things. So let's get to some of the answers, all the answers, I should say, some tricky ones in here. So let's go. Question number one was, for which film did Rita Hayworth have her trademark red hair cut short and dyed blonde? Was it A, The Strawberry Blonde, B, The Lady from Shanghai, C, Pal Joey, or D, Cover Girl? The answer is The Lady from Shanghai, B. Question two was, this monster star was also the star of another classic television show where he played a police officer. Who is the actor and what is the name of the show? The answer, Fred Gwynne and Car 54, Where Are You? Question three, who was the first woman to speak in a horror film and in what movie? The answer, Carla Laemmle in Dracula from 1931. Question four, in what classic 1942 film do we hear the line, "Don't let's ask for the moon, we have the stars"? It was Now Voyager, and the character was Charlotte Vale. Now Voyager, wonderful film. Question five, Inspector Jacques Clouseau was portrayed by four different actors in the Pink Panther films. Name all four actors who played the iconic character. The answer, Peter Sellers, Alan Arkin, Roger Moore, and Steve Martin. Question number six from Geraldine Viswanathan. It was, who was the first feature-length animated film, or what was the first feature-length animated film ever released? Was it Snow White and Seven Dwarves, Bambi, Cinderella, or Pinocchio? The answer, Snow White and the Seven Dwarves, A. Question seven, which well-known television actress gave birth in real life on the same day as her TV character? Do you know the answer? Lucille Ball, another great redhead. Question eight, Casablanca is based on an unproduced stage play written by Murray Burnett and Joan Allison. What was the name of that stage play? It was Everybody Comes to Rick's. Question nine, Jimmy Stewart starred in four films directed by Alfred Hitchcock. In which one of those four films did Stewart play a doctor? Was it The Man Who Knew Too Much, Rope, Vertigo, or Rear Window? It was The Man Who Knew Too Much, A. And question 10 in Butch Cassidy and the Sundance Kid, what South American country do the title characters travel to towards the end of the movie? The answer, Bolivia. I hope you got some of those answers correct and are enjoying playing along with this trivia-a-thon. It's been so much fun for me to take part. Don't forget to donate if you can. And that's it for my round, but I'm going to hand it off to another HCA colleague, the wonderful and very talented Rama.
Hello. Alrighty then. Thank you so much, Alicia. My name is Rama, or in the underground world, I'm also known as the Troll Hunter. No, just simply Rama is fine. Okay, so welcome to round five, a grand old sci-fi time. We're going to be talking about science fiction here. And before we get into it, just want to let you know that we are supporting the charity organization called United Way. United Way improves lives by mobilizing the caring power of communities around the world to advance the common good. That's their mission. But they've also done some great stuff like building classrooms in the Philippines, distributing mosquitoes in Uganda. And of course, they're actively helping people in need right now during this COVID pandemic. All right. So again, for those of you guys, your team names, your emails, the same as the ones in the previous rounds, keep it that way. And we're going to get to the first question that comes in the form of this video, lovely video featuring writer-director of one of my favorite movies of the past decade, Searching, Anish Chaganty.
Hey guys, I'm Anish Chaganty, the writer and director of a movie called Searching, and I've got a trivia question for you. The director of this film put together a conference of futurists to talk about what the future would look like in 2054. What is that movie? Hey guys, I'm Anish Chaganti, the writer and director of a movie called Searching, and I've got a trivia question for you. The director of this film put together a conference of futurists to talk about what the future would look like in 2054. What is that movie?
Thank you, Anish. And can we put up the question on the screen again if you didn't get to hear it correctly or well enough? So, okay, here it is. The director of this film put together a conference of futurists to talk about what the future would look like in 2054. What is the name of that movie? All right. Okay, second question. Who voiced BB-8 in Star Wars The Force Awakens? You guys know this. I know you know this. All right. Question number three. There you go. What 1972 space drama was remade in 2002 by director Steven Soderbergh? I repeat, what 1972 space drama was remade or rebooted in 2002 by director Steven Soderbergh? All right, question number four. What lead singer of a popular 80s new wave rock band auditioned for the role of Princess Leia? I repeat, what lead singer of a popular 80s new wave rock band auditioned for the role of Princess Leia? An iconic character. All right, who are the two performers who played Starbuck in Battlestar Galactica? Love this series, both the original and the reboot. Who are the two performers who played Starbuck in Battlestar Galactica? All right. Oh, look at that. The question comes from the handsome me. All right. What is Sulu's primary position on the USS Enterprise? I repeat, what is Hikaru Sulu's primary position on the USS Enterprise? Okay. Next question. What are the colors of the light cycles that Tron, Flynn, and Ram ride in the original Tron? What are the colors of the light cycles that Tron, Flynn, and Ram ride in the original Tron? What is the name of the alien in the original The Day the Earth Stood Still, released in 1951? Woo, this is a thinker. What is the name of the alien in the original The Day the Earth Stood Still, released in 1951? In Netflix Shira, I've always been wanting to watch this, I haven't yet. What is Shadow Weaver's true identity? I repeat, in Netflix's She-Ra series, what is Shadow Weaver's true identity? Oh, okay, I think that's... Before I make another round at the questions again real quickly, to remind you, please donate to United Way. They are doing great work out there, especially during this COVID pandemic. That's United Way. So it's a fantastic organization. Donate to them right now. Oh, there you go. At Venmo at Hollywood Critics. Thank you so much for that. Appreciate it. So, giving you guys some time to write down your answers on your sheet. Okay, let's do another round again. Okay, here you go. From Anisha Ganti, the director of Searching. He said, the director of this film put together a conference of futurists to talk about what the future would look like in 2054. What is the name of that movie? Next. Who voiced BB-8 in Star Wars The Force Awakens? I love this one. What 1972 space drama was remade in 2002 by director Steven Soderbergh? What lead singer of a popular 80s new wave rock band auditioned for the role of Princess Leia? Who are the two performers who played Starbuck in Battlestar Galactica? What is Sulu's primary position on the USS Enterprise? Thank you, Rama. What are the colors of the light cycles that Tron, Flynn, and Ram ride in the original Tron? What is the name of the alien in the original The Day the Earth Stood Still, released in 1951? In Netflix Shara, what is Shadow Weaver's true identity? All right, let's hit that 60-second clock. Time for some dramatic music.
People started hating that clock. I don't know if I should play it anymore.
Oh, okay.
I think like we have so much time going by at this point. I think we could just have a conversation here for like 5 minutes. But yeah, I feel like everyone's like, it's dramatic. So I decided to skip on it. So Ash, whenever the round is closed, let me know. So Ashley's telling me to talk to you, Rama. Fill in the gap here a little bit. I just decided, I mean, should I put the 60-second timer back on? I didn't know if everyone was kind of like over it because it was so dramatic. So that's the reason why I pulled it out. So I'll put it back in for the next round. I just figured maybe it was too much time. So
no worries. I thought it was cool. I don't think I can get over it.
Okay, sounds good. All right, Ash, are we we're good? Can we close out this round? Let's close out this round, I think.
Yeah.
All right, Rama, take it away.
Awesome, possum. All right, so I think this is the part where I'm going to be revealing the answers to you guys. So can we put those up on the screen? There you go. The director of this film put together a conference of futurists to talk about what the future would look like in 2054. What is the name of that movie? And the answer is Minority Report. Yeah, thank you, Scott. Woohoo! And thank you, Anish. Who voiced BB-8 in Star Wars The Force Awakens? Asked Peter Serretta. And the answer is Bill Hader. By the way, go check out his show on HBO, Barry. Fantastic. What 1972 space drama was remade in 2002 by Oscar-winning director Steven Soderbergh? And the answer is Solaris. What lead singer of a popular 80s new wave rock band auditioned for the role of Princess Leia? And the answer is Terry Nunn of Berlin. Who are the two performers who played Starbuck in Battlestar Galactica? The two answers are... Oh. There you go. Dirk Benedict and Kati Sackhoff. Dirk Benedict is also Faceman in one of my favorite series, The A-Team. What is Sulu's primary position on the USS Enterprise? And the answer is Chief Helmsman, who works alongside with the navigator. What are the colors of the light cycles that Tron, Flynn, and Ram ride in the original Tron? The answer is... Yes, red, orange, and yellow. So you have to have all those three on your answer. Okay. What is the name of the alien in the original The Day the Earth Stood Still, released in 1951? And the answer is Klaatu. Yeah. In Netflix's Shara, what is Shadow Weaver's true identity? And the answer is Light Spinner. Yes. And that's it. Quick again reminder, please donate to United Way at our Venmo. And they do great work right now for COVID relief. So please, please, please donate if you can. And thank you so much for tuning into my round. And I'm going to hand it over now to the next one. It is the lovely Jazz. Hey, thank you so much, you guys. Take it away, Jazz.
Thanks, Rama. Well, welcome to round six. Don't forget to fill in your email address and keep that consistent. And I hope you're having a great time. So yes, round six is a splendid time for all. I know I've been watching the chat room and I see you all wanting the horror round, and that's going to be Simon's round, which is next. But anyway, so my course tonight is Dine11, and their website is dine11.org. And basically what they do is they've teamed up with the rest of restaurants around the country to donate meals to those on the front line. So it's doctors and nurses, and who are obviously working around the clock during the pandemic. And Ariane Phillips, the costume designer, brought this course to my attention. And so donate through the Hollywood Critic demo page, through our PayPal, or directly through dine11.org.
So let's kick off round six. And before I do that, let me just introduce myself. My name is Jazz Tanke. I write for Variety. I'm the artisan's editor, so I deal with all the cross people. And yeah, that's me. So, okay, let's kick off with question number one. And this is actually a video from Brooklyn Prince, who is in Apple's Home Before Dark. If you haven't seen it, check it out. Let's get Brooklyn's video.
Hi guys, I'm Brooklyn Prince, and I am Skipper, and we are here to ask you a trivia question today. What is Barbie's full name? A, Barbara Jean Scott. B, Barbara Millicent Roberts. C, Barbie Doll. Or D, Barbara Lynn Prince. What's the answer?
All right, so Brooklyn's question was, what is Barbie's full name? Is it A, Barbara Jean Scott, B, Barbara Millicent Roberts, C, Barbie Doll, or D, Barbara Lynn Prince? And here's the fun fact, apparently Barbie's been in 36 animated movies, and there's actually a live action movie that Margot Robbie has optioned and is gonna be in production. So we'll see when we get back to work and, you know, cameras are rolling, we'll see what happens. Anyway, moving on to question number two. What candy did Steven Spielberg want E.T. to eat in the film, but the corporate heads said they wanted nothing to do with an alien eating their movie, their candy in a movie? Once more. What candy did Steven Spielberg want E.T. to eat in the film, but the corporate heads said they wanted nothing to do with an alien eating their candy in a movie? All right, question number three. What is currently the record holder for the best reviewed movie ever on Rotten Tomatoes? And yes, it's a family movie. So think hard right there. What is currently the record holder for the best reviewed movie ever on Rotten Tomatoes? And it's a family film. All right. Question number four. Which of the following family films did Brad Bird not direct? So which of the following family films did Brad Bird not direct? Was it A, Tomorrowland, B, The Iron Giant, C, Monsters, Inc., or D, Ratatouille? So which of the following films did Brad Bird not direct? A, Tomorrowland, B, The Iron Giant, C, Monsters, Inc., D, Ratatouille? All right.
Hey everyone, this is John M. Chu. I'm the director of Crazy Rich Asians. All right, so here's the question. During Chunk's confession in The Goonies, what did he say he did in the fifth grade? Good luck.
Right. Did you get that? John Chu asked for question number 5. During his confession in The Goonies, what does Chunk say he did in the 5th grade? All right. Question number 6. In Jim Henson's Labyrinth, why should someone avoid the phrase, "It's a piece of cake"? Once more. In Jim Henson's Labyrinth, why should someone avoid the phrase, "It's a piece of cake"? Okay. Question number 7. What 2006 animated movie had Community creator Dan Harmon as one of its 3 credited screenwriters? Question number 7 again is, what 2006 animated movie had Community creator Dan Harmon as one of its 3 credited screenwriters? All right. Question number 8. What prolific science fiction author wrote the screenplay for a made-for-TV animated adaptation of his 1973 fantasy novel of the same name? Name the author as well as the book or TV movie. And here's a hint. It's Crazy Ex-Girlfriend star creator Rachel Bloom made a song about him. So all you Crazy Ex-Girlfriend fans, think hard. So once again, what prolific science fiction author wrote the screenplay for a made-for-TV animated adaptation of his 1973 fantasy novel of the same name, named the author as well as the book or TV movie. All right, question number 9. In the movie Space Jam, who was in the starting lineup for the Tune Squad? So, in the movie Space Jam, who was in the starting lineup for the Tune Squad? Okay, and number 10, we're going to end this round. Oh, sorry.
Hey, movie trivia players, I've got a multiple choice question for you. Christopher Lloyd was in all of the following family films, except for one. Can you guess which? Is it A, Camp Nowhere with Andrew Keegan? Is it B, Angels in the Outfield with Joe Gordon-Levitt? Is it C, Dennis the Menace with Walter Matthau? Or is it D, Casper with Christina Ricci and the incorrigible Bill Pullman? Guess which one?
Okay, let's do that. Thank you, Paul Walter Hauser. Christopher Lloyd was in all but one of the following family films. Which film was he not in? Was it A, Camp Nowhere, B, Angels in the Outfield, C, Dennis the Menace, or D, Casper? All right. Thank you for all the videos. And once again, you know, we're doing this tonight for giving back to the community, giving back. So please donate to either through our Venmo page, PayPal, and my chosen charity for tonight, dine11.org. All right. So we're going to go through this one more time with all the questions. All right, starting at number 1 again. What is Barbie's full name? Is it A, Barbara Dean Scott, B, Barbara Millicent Roberts, C, if she's a plain old Barbie girl, or D, if she's Barbara Lynn Prince? Question number 2. What candy did Steven Spielberg want E.T. to eat in the film, but the corporate head said they wanted nothing to do with an alien eating their candy in a movie? Question 3. What is currently the record holder for best reviewed movie ever on Rotten Tomatoes? And yes, it's a family film. All right, question number 4. Which of the following family films did Brad Bird not direct? Was it A, Tomorrowland, B, The Iron Giant, C, Monsters, Inc., or D, Ratatouille? All right, number 5, Goonie fans. During his confession in the Goonies, what does Chunk say he did in the 5th grade? All right, question number 6. Indian Henson's Labyrinth, why should someone avoid the phrase, "It's a piece of cake"? Question number 7. What 2006 animated movie had Community creator Dan Harmon as one of its 3 credited writers? All right, question number 8. What prolific science fiction author wrote the screenplay for a made-for-TV animated adaptation of the 1973 fantasy novel of the same name. Name the author as well as the name of the book and TV movie. All right, question number 9. In the movie Space Jam, who was in the starting lineup for the Toon Squad? And the final question in the round, Christopher Lloyd was in all but one of the following family films. Which film was he not in? Was it A, Camp Nowhere, B, Angel in the Outfield, C, Dennis the Menace, or D, Casper? All right. And before we go to the countdown, I'm really just going to announce the winner of our social media raffle. And the answer for the winner goes to Michael Leone. So congratulations, Michael, and message us on Twitter, and we'll let you know how to claim your prize. All right, let's do the countdown.
T-minus 40 seconds. T-minus 30 seconds. T-minus 20 seconds. Ten, nine, eight, seven, six, five, four, three, two, one, zero.
All right, well, let's see how you do. Round 6 is now closed. All right, we're going to go through the answers. The answer to question number 1, what is Barbie's full name? Was it A, Barbara Dean Scott, B, Barbara Millicent Roberts, is it C, Barbie Doll, or D, Barbara Lynn Prince? And the
All right, guys, for the answer, we have a special guest. Hi, guys, it's Barbie. Does anyone know the answer? I do! Okay, best boyfriend ever, a.k.a. Ken Carson. Whoop whoop. The answer is Barbara Millicent Roberts! Ken knows everything about Barbie. He's like the best boyfriend ever.
Thank you, Brooklyn. Well, the answer to that was...
All right, guys.
Barbara Millicent Roberts. All right, for question number 2, what candy did Steven Spielberg want E.T. to eat in the film, but the corporate head said they wanted nothing to do with an alien eating their candy in a movie? And the answer to that is M&M's. All right, question number 3, what is currently the record holder for the best reviewed movie ever on Rotten Tomatoes? And yes, it's a family film. It's a cute little bear, Paddington 2. All right, number 4, which of the following family films did Brad Bird not direct? Was it A, Tomorrowland, B, The Iron Giant, C, Monsters, Inc., or D, Ratatouille? The answer is Monsters, Inc. All right, Goonie fans, during his confession in The Goonies, what does Chunk say he did in the 5th grade? The answer is, I knocked my sister down the stairs and I blamed it on the dog. Sorry, I can't do a Chunk impression. I'm not going to do it. All right. The answer to question number 6. In Jim Henson's Labyrinth, why did someone avoid the phrase, it's a piece of cake? Because something bad always happens right after. Okay.
T-minus 40 seconds.
All right. Question number 7. What animated movie had community creator Dan Harmon as one of its 3 credited screenwriters? And the answer to that is Monster House. All right, question number 8. What prolific science fiction author wrote the screenplay for a made-for-TV animated adaptation of his 1973 fantasy novel of the same name? He named the author and the book or TV movie. And the answer was A Halloween Treat, written by Ray Bradbury. All right, Space Jam fans, in the movie Space Jam, who was in the starting lineup for the Toon Squad? And the answer to that was Michael Jordan, Bugs Bunny, and Lola Bunny, and the Tasmanian Devil, and Daffy Duck. All right. Okay. Last question of this round was, Christopher Lloyd was in all but one of the following family films. Which film was he not in? Was it A, Camp Nowhere, B, Angels in the Outfield, C, Dennis the Menace, or D, Casper?
The answer, of course, was D, Casper. Christopher Lloyd wasn't in Casper, you idiots. You stupid, stupid idiots. Christopher Lloyd wasn't in Casper. You idiots.
I could watch that on repeat. Thank you so much, Paul. And I didn't know that. So there you go. Just one quick reminder. Don't forget the big prize that Scott mentioned at the beginning. You can still enter for that. And the way you enter is simply donate to us. Or put it to our Venmo or to our PayPal. And that's me. I hope you're doing really well. And now it's the round we've all been waiting for, round number 7. Simon Thompson hosting Horrifically Horrifying.
Thank you, Jazz. Really appreciate that. I feel completely berated by Paul Waterhauser there. That was both hilarious and intimidating. And as Jazz just said, don't forget that you only have until the end of round 8 to enter and win that big prize. It is a big prize by donating. And obviously, you know the information for donating already, and you can find it in the comments section. Okay, so who the hell am I? My name is Simon Thompson. I'm a writer and producer of Fresh Daily on Quibi. I also write for a number of different outlets, including Forbes and Variety and IGN. And I can also be found commentating on film for the likes of the BBC. I'm also a board member of the HCA and produce for E! News as well. So this is my basically one evening off. And I'm here to help raise money for a number of really important charities. So thank you so much for, first of all, being here and also donating. One of tonight's charities that we are raising funds for is the Actors Fund, the charity that supports performers and behind-the-scenes workers in the world of performing arts and entertainment, helping more than 17,000 people directly each year. And they recently, as part of their COVID-19 fundraising, recently raised a staggering $10 million, thanks to people like you. So let's help keep that invaluable money coming in and helping people like you, like me, and the people that we love watching on TV and film, both in front of the camera and behind. We really appreciate it. Thank you so much. Okay, so here is the long-awaited horror round, Horrifically Horrifying, and I was very kindly chosen to host this round due to my face. Which is understandable, which is quite grim. Okay, let's get to the first question. This first one is from James, I believe, who looked lovely there for a second.
You like scary movies?
Uh-huh.
What's your favorite scary movie?
Yeah, okay. The first question in this round, the horror round here, for the HCA Movie and TV Triviathon is, many big stars have spent a bit of time in horror, but what 80s slasher film, which 1980 slasher film flick, features Tom Hanks and a psychopath with a penchant for going after brides-to-be? I'll read that question again. Many big stars have spent a bit of time in horror. What 1980 slasher flick features Tom Hanks and a psychopath with a penchant for going after brides-to-be? I literally had no idea this film existed, which was embarrassing. So thanks to James for that question. Next question from Heather. What is the name of the novel that Gale Weathers publishes in the Scream franchise? What is the name of the novel that Gale Weathers publishes in the Scream franchise? Brilliant franchise there, which we're gratefully seeing revived very soon, which is awesome. The next question is going to be a video question from someone who's become quite a titan in the world of horror.
Hello, David F. Sandberg here with a horror question for you. One of the better horror remakes, in my opinion, is David Cronenberg's The Fly, but it was actually produced by someone very well known for comedy and who was worried that his name on it would make people think it was a comedy. Do you know who that is?
So the question there from David, what producer best known for producing comedies also produced David Cronenberg's remake of The Fly? Who is the producer? Thank you to David for that video question there. I think he's going to go quite far. Shannon McGrew, the question from her next. Where did Channel Zero draw inspiration for their horror anthology from? It's interesting. Abby Bernstein next. What secret was Gina Davis's character hiding from everyone in the TV series of The Exorcist? And a little reminder here at this point, just to remember to make sure that you have all your questions coming in from the same email address. So that makes it easy for you to win the points. Okay, the sixth question in this round is going to be a video question from somebody you might recognize.
Okay, I actually don't know the answer to this, which is pretty scary. So I'm excited to find out. Here it is. On top of co-starring with me in Zombieland Double Tap, this person and I also share a connection in that we both were in shows created by Ryan Murphy. Who's the co-star and what's the name of their series? Tell me. I don't know.
She literally doesn't know. Zoe there with on top of co-starring with her in Zombieland Double Tap, this person and she also share a connection that they both starred in TV shows created by Ryan Murphy. Who is that co-star? And what is the name of the TV show? Okay, seventh question in this round from Stacy. Who was the first actor A Nightmare on Elm Street director Wes Craven approached to play the villain Freddy Krueger? Who was the first actor that A Nightmare on Elm Street director Wes Craven approached to play the villain Freddy Krueger? Completely unrelated to the answer, but I don't know if you knew that the reason that Johnny Depp got a role in A Nightmare on Elm Street was down to basically Nicolas Cage. There you go. Thank you, Nicolas. Okay, next question from Zachary. The 1975 classic Jaws is considered to be the world's first blockbuster, so much so that it ultimately inspired many knockoffs. What was the name of the Jaws knockoff released by Japanese studio Toho in 1977? The 1975 classic Jaws is considered to be the world's first blockbuster, so much so that it ultimately inspired many knockoffs. What was the name of the Jaws knockoff released by Japanese studio Toho in 1977? Thanks, Zachary, for that one. Okay, the ninth question in this round is another video. I'm assuming it was recorded on a house on Haunted Hill or somewhere?
Hi, everybody. This is Mike Flanagan, and it is my pleasure to ask you guys the following trivia question. What was the name of Danny Torrance's imaginary friend in The Shining?
Amazing having memorabilia from The Shining and living in Hill House. Mildly terrifying. Thank you, Mike, for that video question. In The Shining, what was the name of Danny Torrance's imaginary friend? In The Shining, what was the name of Danny Torrance's imaginary friend? The brilliant Mike Flanagan there. Okay, and the 10th and final question in this round before we go through them all is another video question.
Everyone knows to stay out of room 237 in Stanley Kubrick's The Shining, but in the book, it wasn't actually room 237. Do you know what it was?
David F. Sandberg again there. Thanks to Stanley Kubrick, everyone knows to stay out of room 237. But in Stephen King's novel, it wasn't actually room 237. What number was it? That's your 10th and final question in this round. Okay, going to remind you one more time. For all your answers, use the correct email address, the one that you've been using all the way through this quiz up to this point. to make sure that all your ads get counted together. And please don't forget to donate. This is all great fun for everybody, but obviously we are here to raise money to help those people who really need help right now in various ways. So thank you for anything that you can spare. Okay, right, let's go back and go through these questions one more time in the seventh round, the horror round. Okay, first question came from James. Many big stars have spent a bit of time in horror, but what 1980 slasher flick features Tom Hanks and a psychopath with a penchant for going after brides-to-be? Question number two. What's the name of the novel that Gale Weathers publishes in the Scream franchise? Third question was a video question from David. What producer, best known for producing comedies, also produced David Cronenberg's remake of The Fly? Who is that producer? Question number four. Where did Channel Zero draw inspiration for their horror anthology from? Okay. Fifth question. What secret was Gina Davis's character hiding from everyone in the TV series of The Exorcist? Sixth question in this round came from Zoe. It was a video question. On top of co-starring with her in Zombieland Double Tap, this person and she also share a connection in that they both starred in TV shows created by Ryan Murphy. Who is that co-star? And what is the name of the TV show? Okay, question seven. Who was the first actor A Nightmare on Elm Street director Wes Craven approached to play the villain Freddy Krueger? Okay, the eighth question from Zach. The 1975 classic Jaws is considered to be the world's first blockbuster, so much so that it ultimately inspired many knockoffs. What was the name of the Jaws knockoff released by the Japanese studio Toho in 1977? Okay, question number nine in this round from Mike Flanagan. In The Shining, what was the name of Danny Torrance's imaginary friend? Question nine, in The Shining, what was the name of Danny Torrance's imaginary friend? And the 10th and final question in this round from David F. Sandberg again. Thanks to Stanley Kubrick, everyone knows to stay out of room 237, but in Stephen King's novel, it wasn't actually room 237. What room was it? Okay, those are all the questions in this seventh round of the quiz, this horror quiz. Okay, write them down, get them sorted out, and here's your timer.
T-minus 40 seconds. T-minus 30 seconds. T-minus 20 seconds. Ten, nine, eight, seven, six, five, four, three, two, one, zero.
Okay, so that round is now over. In fact, more over than somebody who says, I'll be right back, when they just pop out for a second in a horror movie. Okay, so let's go through, sorry, that was terrible. Let's go through all the questions with the answers and find out how correct you are and how amazingly smart you all are. Many big stars have spent a bit of time in horror. What 1980 slasher flick features Tom Hanks and a psychopath with a penchant for going after brides-to-be? The answer? He knows you're alone. He knows you're alone. Second question, that's from Heather. What's the name of the novel that Gale Weathers publishes in the Scream franchise? And the answer is Clock of Doom. Clock of Doom was the correct answer there. The third question was delivered by David, and I believe he's got the answer. But if he doesn't,
he does not.
Oh, for God's sake, David, make some effort. doing a job half. Okay, what producer, best known for producing comedies, also produced David Cronenberg's remake of The Fly? Who was that producer? That producer was Stuart Cornfield, of the famous Cornfield family. Okay, number four. Where did Channel Zero draw inspiration for their horror anthology from? The answer, internet stories known as creepypastas? I did not know that. That is a thing. Okay, number five. What secret was Gina Davis's character hiding from everyone in the TV series of The Exorcist? The answer? Well, she's a 12-year-old girl who was possessed in William Peter Blatty's original novel and the subsequent film adaptation. She is actually Regan. Awkward. I wonder if that's on her resume. Number six was a question from Zoe. The question was, on top of co-starring with her in Zombieland Double Tap, this person and she also share a connection in that they both starred in TV shows created by Ryan Murphy. Who is that co-star and what is the name of the TV show? Abigail Breslin and Scream Queens. So Abigail Breslin and Scream Queens. Question number seven, who was the first actor A Nightmare on Elm Street director Wes Craven approached to play the villain Freddy Krueger? And the answer is David Warner. David Warner was the first person asked by Wes Craven to play Freddy Krueger. Number eight, the 1975 classic Jaws is considered to be the world's first blockbuster, so much so that it ultimately inspired many knockoffs. What was the name of the Jaws knockoff released by Japanese studio Toho in 1977? The answer was House, aka Houseu, I'm assuming. My Japanese is a little bit rusty as I don't know any Japanese. Number nine, in The Shining, what was the name of Danny Torrance's imaginary friend? That question from the brilliant Mike Flanagan. And the answer is Tony. Tony is the correct answer. And number 10, David F. Sandberg asked, thanks to Stanley Kubrick, everyone knows to stay out of room 237. But in Stephen King's novel, it wasn't actually room 237. What room number was it? And the answer is room 217, which turns out was just a horrendous typo. Okay, so those are all your answers and your questions and some amazing videos from some very, very charitable people. And talking of charitable people, please be one of those and don't forget to donate. That's the end of the hour around. Enough of these face. It's pretty grim. I've taken up enough of your time already. Morgan is going to have the next round for you, independent films. Morgan.
Hi, thank you, Simon. Yeah, absolutely.
My pleasure. It's I now look particularly grotesque.
Oh, stop it. I have a ring light that helps.
Okay, cool.
You know. Thank you. Yes. So, yes, my name is Morgan Rojas. I am the founder and editor-in-chief of Cinemacy, which is an online independent film review website. You can find us at cinemacy.com. We make it pretty simple. And I am so excited to be hosting the independent film round here at the HCA Triviathon, and even more excited to be honoring Feeding America, which is the charity that your donation will be supporting in this round. A little background really quickly. Feeding America is the nation's largest domestic hunger relief organization. They work with 200 other food banks in its network, and they help give food to 46 million people who don't know where their next meal is coming from. And that's something that no person should have to think about and struggle with. And so your donation will be helping Feeding America, and you will help solve the hunger crisis. So please, if you can, donate the Venmo or PayPal at Hollywood Critics. I also want to make a quick note that the end of my round is the cutoff for entering the donation raffle for the big prize at the end. So please donate if you can via PayPal or Venmo, and every $5 donation gets you an entry into the raffle. So good luck, donate, and let's start our round.
What are your plans for the weekend?
I'm going to do some grocery shopping
and rent a film to watch in the comfort of my own home.
Did that answer your question?
Yay. We all love independent films, right? I'm a huge Alma Harrell stan, love indie films. I'm so excited for this round. I hope you are too. So let's get started. Question number one comes to us from a video from a very special person. Let's play that now.
Hi, everybody. I'm Nicholas Bertel, sending love and best wishes from here in New York City.
My trivia question is a film music trivia question. What movie is the following piece from, and who is the composer?
Amazing. Okay, so name the composer and the film. We have, okay, bear with me. A, Max Steiner from A Summer Place. B, Ennio Morricone from Cinema Paradiso. C, Shigeru Ohmayashi for In the Mood for Love. And D, Ezra Reed for A Trip to the Moon. So those are your options for question number one. Thank you, Nicholas Bertel. Very, very excited for Succession to come back. I can't wait. That is my favorite show on TV right now. Okay, question number one. Question number two. How many films has director Pedro Almodovar made with actor Antonio Banderas so far? Again, the question is, how many films has director Pedro Almodovar made with actor Antonio Banderas so far? Okay, question number three. In what city and state was the Peanut Butter Falcon filmed? Again, in what city and state was the Peanut Butter Falcon filmed? And question number four. Before Miles Teller played the character of Andrew Neiman in the 2014 film Whiplash, another actor played his character in the short film from writer and director Damien Chazelle. Who was the original actor to play Andrew? Again, the question is, before Miles Teller played the character of Andrew Neiman in the 2014 film Whiplash, another actor played his character in the short film from writer and director Damien Chazelle. Who was the original actor to play Andrew? Question number five comes from me. And the question is, what film earned Greta Gerwig her first directorial credit? I am also a Greta Gerwig stan to the max. The question again, what film earned Greta Gerwig her first directorial credit? Okay, question number six. When Ex Machina won the Best Visual Effects Oscar, it was the lowest grossing winner in the category since what film? When Ex Machina won the Best Visual Effects Oscar, it was the lowest grossing winner in the category since what film? Okay, question number seven. Who plays Emily, the librarian, in The Station Agent? Who plays Emily, the librarian, in The Station Agent? Okay, next question. What was the first film to ever be released by A24? Got a lot of good ones, but we're looking for the first one. What was the first film to ever be released by A24? Okay, question number nine is another video from someone who is very special. And I am excited to play that now.
What's up, everybody? I'm Kelvin Harrison Jr., and I have a trivia question for you. What actress did John Cassavetes work with on 11 films? What's up, everybody? I'm Kelvin Harrison Jr., and I have a trivia question for you. What actress did John Cassavetes work with on 11 films?
Okay, what actress did John Cassavetes work with on 11 films? Thank you, Kelvin Harrison Jr. We love you. Good man right there. Okay, so those are all of your questions for the independent film round. And I'm going to read through them one more time just so you have a minute to, I don't know, answer any questions that you left blank. These are some good questions. And if you don't know the answer, when you find out the answer in a minute and a half, knowledge, independent film knowledge that you will just have from now on. So fantastic. All right, let's start from the top. Question number one from Nicholas Bertel. Name the composer and the film. I hope you remember the piano score.
Morgan, do you want me to play that again? You think I should play that again?
Yeah, better him than me. So yes.
Okay. Please. All right. Let me play that again.
Okay.
Hi, everybody. I'm Nicholas Bertel, sending love and best wishes from here in New York City. My trivia question is a film music trivia question. What movie is the following piece from, and who is the composer?
Okay, thank you, Nicholas. I could listen to that all day long. Name the composer and the film from that wonderful piece. Is it A, Max Steiner, A Summer Place, Ennio Morricone from Cinema Paradiso, Sigaro Umbayashi in The Mood for Love, or Ezra Reed, which I hope I'm saying that right, A Trip to the Moon? That was question number one. Question number two. How many films has director Pedro Almodovar made with actor Antonio Banderas so far? Question number two. Question number three. In what city and state was The Peanut Butter Falcon filmed? Which, if you haven't seen that movie, I highly recommend. It's a perfect quarantine watch for sure. Okay, number four. Before Miles Teller played the character of Andrew Neiman in the 2014 film Whiplash, another actor played his character in the short film from writer and director Damien Chazelle. Who was the original actor to play Andrew? Question number five. What film earned Greta Gerwig her first directorial credit? The very first one. Number six. When Ex Machina won the Best Visual Effects Oscar, it was the lowest grossing winner in the category since what film? Number seven, who plays Emily, the librarian in The Station Agent? Okay, question number eight. What was the first film to ever be released by A24? Okay, question number nine. What actress did John Cassavetes work with on 11 films? There you go. Those are all of your questions for the independent film round. We're going to give you a few more seconds to kind of figure those out. Make sure that your, like everyone has been saying before, your email is the same. Donate. If you have all your answers already and you're good to go, this is a perfect time to donate to Feeding America or any other charity of your choice right now. So let's start the countdown now.
What are your plans for the weekend?
I'm going to do some grocery shopping and rent a film to watch in the comfort of my own home.
Did that answer your question?
Yes, the art of self-defense.
Hi, I'm Nicholas Bertel, sending love and best wishes from here in New York City. My trivia question is a film music trivia question. What movie is the following piece from, and who is the composer?
I figure that was better than the countdown timer.
Yeah, so. I agree.
All right,
Morgan.
You can
send that to me after the fact, too. I'd love to just like listen to that.
Absolutely, absolutely. Cool. Okay, you're doing great. Go
Thanks.
For it.
All right, so I hope everyone has their answers. Let's get started with the answers. The answer to question number one, name the composer and the film. The answer is C, Shigeru Umebayashi for In the Mood for Love. Okay, question number two. How many films has director Pedro Almodovar made with actor Antonio Banderas so far? That answer is eight. Eight movies. It's a lot of movies. Okay, number three. In what city and state was the Peanut Butter Falcon filmed? That answer is Outer Banks, North Carolina. Okay, before Miles Teller played the character of Andrew Neiman in the 2014 film Whiplash, another actor played his character in the short film from writer and director Damien Chazelle. Who was the original actor to play Andrew? And that answer is Johnny Simmons. Bravo to that. That I didn't know before this. See, good indie film knowledge I've learned. Okay. What film earned Greta Gerwig her first directorial credit? No, it's not Lady Bird. Contrary to popular belief, that was her first solo directorial credit. She co-directed Nights and Weekends, which is another, you know, great. They're all great movies, so that was another good one. Okay, when Ex Machina won the Best Visual Effects Oscar, it was the lowest grossing winner in the category since what film? The answer is What Dreams May Come. Who plays Emily the librarian in The Station Agent? That answer is the wonderful Michelle Williams. Okay, here we go. What was the first film to ever be released by A24? Drum roll. A Glimpse Inside the Mind of Charles Swan III. Okay, Kelvin Harrison Jr. wrapping up this round. What actress did John Cassavetes work on 11 films with?
All of you got this right. It was Gina Rowlands, the icon. A dream. Yes.
There we go, Gina Rowlands. Thank you, Kelvin. Thank you, Nicholas Bertel, for submitting your videos. Thank you all for playing and for joining me in this round and joining the Hollywood Critics Association for raising money for all these different charities supporting COVID-19 relief. I want to pass this on now to wrap things up with Terrence, who is in the final round. Thank you so much for joining. I hope you're having a drink as well, Terrence.
Yes, I will be.
Once good. That was probably smart.
Of live videos over.
You're good. All right, cool. Well, good luck. And thank you.
Yeah, thank you so much, Morgan. And I hope you guys have had a really great time. This is the final round. Very excited to present this. My name is Terrence Johnson. I am on the board of the HCA, and I write at lenoirtour.net. And the category I am happy to present is called Drama, Drama, Drama. We're getting to the mess. And I believe our first question is going to be a video from somebody.
Drama!
All right, awesome. I love the seamless flow of Nicholas Britell being in the previous section and then his succession theme being the music for our drama teaser. So like I said, there'll be several questions. And question number one, we have a video.
Hi, Leah Thompson. While he was ultimately replaced in Back to the Future, Eric Stoltz and I starred in two other movies in the 80s. What were the names of those movies?
So once again, while he was ultimately replaced by Michael J. Fox as Marty McFly in Back to the Future, Leah Thompson ended up starring alongside Eric Stoltz in two other movies in the 80s. What are those films? All right, question number two. The final scene of Fight Club features a song by which American rock band? Is it A, the Afghan Wings, B, Nirvana, C, the Pixies, or D, the Strokes? So once again, the final scene of Fight Club features a song by which American rock band? A, the Afghan Wings, B, Nirvana, C, the Pixies, or D, the Strokes? Question number three, what happened to Sam Waterston's character, Charlie, in the HBO series, The Newsroom? Once again, what happens to Sam Waterston's character, Charlie, in the HBO series, The Newsroom? Question number four, what actor delivered the proposition to Demi Moore and Woody Harrelson in Indecent Proposal? What actor delivered the proposition to Demi Moore and Woody Harrelson in Indecent Proposal? Our leader, Scott Menzel, with a deep cut here on question number five. What scripted LGBTQ Showtime series was later turned into a reality-based series before being revived for a single season in 2019. So once again, what scripted LGBTQ Showtime series was later turned into a reality-based series before being revived for a single season in 2019? Question number six. Which Golden Globe winning actor currently plays the patriarch of the family on HBO's Succession? I will repeat. Question number six. Which Golden Globe winning actor currently plays the patriarch of the family on HBO's Succession? Awesome. Next up is question number seven. In the 2006 drama The Lake House, how do Keanu Reeves and Sandra Bullock's characters communicate? In the 2006 drama The Lake House, how do Keanu Reeves and Sandra Bullock's characters communicate? Ooh, this is a good one. Question number eight. Who directed the original pilot for Game of Thrones? Once again, who directed the original pilot for Game of Thrones? Question number nine. What was the first original series released on Netflix? I'm sure all of us have been logging in those Netflix hours, but what was the first original series that they released? And finally, Lindsay Lohan co-starred with Jane Fonda in what movie? Lindsay Lohan co-starred with Jane Fonda in what movie? All right, awesome. So I hope you guys have had a great time as we've been doing this, and that if you have it to give, you should donate to any of the various charities that we've been able to talk about. Right now, I guess we will run, you can do so. Thank you, Scott, at our Venmo, Hollywood Critics, or via PayPal, which you can see the URL for right down. I hope I'm pointing to it, right down below. So yeah, let's run through the questions one more time before we get to the answers. So the first question, while he was ultimately replaced by Michael J. Fox as Marty McFly in Back to the Future, Leah Thompson ended up starring alongside Eric Stoltz in two other films in the 1980s. What were those movies? Question number two. The final scene of Fight Club features a song by which American rock band? Is it A, the Afghan Wings, B, Nirvana, C, the Pixies, or D, the Strokes? Question number three, what happens to Sam Waterston's character Charlie in the HBO series, The Newsroom? Question number four, what actor delivered the proposition to Demi Moore and Woody Harrelson in Indecent Proposal? Question number five, what scripted LGBTQ Showtime series was later turned into a reality-based series before being revived for a single season in 2019? Question number six, which Golden Globe-winning actor currently plays the patriarch of the family on HBO's Succession? Question number seven, in the 2006 drama The Lake House, how do Keanu Reeves and Sandra Bullock's characters communicate? Question number eight, who directed the original pilot for Game of Thrones? Question number nine, what was the first original series released on Netflix? And the final question of this round, question number 10, Lindsay Lohan co-starred with Jane Fonda in what movie? And now we will have some sort of epic countdown clock situation, I'm sure, Scott, right?
T-minus 40 seconds. T-minus 30 seconds. T-minus 20 seconds. Ten, nine, eight, seven, six, five, four, three, two, one, zero.
All right, that countdown makes me feel like I'm in Tron, which is pretty cool. So yeah, now let's run through the answers and see if you got them correct. So the answer to the first question, while he was ultimately replaced by Michael J. Fox as Marty McFly in Back to the Future, Leah Thompson ended up starring alongside Eric Stoltz in two other films in the 1980s. What were those?
The answer is The Wild Life and Some Kind of Wonderful.
All right. Thank you, Leah. The answer is The Wild Life and Some Kind of Wonderful. Question number two. The final scene of Fight Club features a song by which American rock band? The answer is C, the Pixies. See the Pixies. Awesome. Question number three, what happens to Sam Waterston's character Charlie in the HBO series The Newsroom? He dies of a heart attack. Question number four, what actor delivered the proposition to Demi Moore and Woody Harrelson in Indecent Proposal? The answer is Robert Redford. What scripted LGBTQ Showtime series was later turned into a reality-based series before being revived for a single season in 2019? And the answer is The L Word. And I didn't even know this. So Scott, that was a great question to ask. I didn't know they made it into a reality series. Number six, which Golden Globe winning actor currently plays the patriarch of the family on HBO's Succession? That would be none other than Brian Cox, AKA William Stryker, from the X-Men movies. Number seven, in the 2006 drama, The Lake House, how do Keanu Reeves and Sandra Bullock's characters communicate? The answer is that they communicate by writing letters to each other. Number eight, who directed the original pilot for Game of Thrones? The answer is Oscar winner Tom McCarthy. Question number nine, what was the first original series released on Netflix? The answer could only be House of Cards. Still remember when that dropped and I spent 13 hours on my couch, not moving, watching the series. And finally, question number 10, Lindsay Lohan co-starred with Jane Fonda in what movie? That movie is none other than Georgia Rule. So yeah, that is all for our drama category. Very excited to find out who the winners of this competition will be. And also really happy that you guys have joined us today. And you know, that we could provide some relief for you during these COVID times, and that we can, you know, hopefully build and work together to get through all of this. If you have, you know, if you haven't had the chance to donate yet, you can definitely do that right now. But I'm going to hand the reins back over to Scott as I am all done with the drama category.
All right. Thanks, Terrence.
Yeah, you're welcome. It's been fun.
All right, buddy. Bye. Take care. All right. So look at that. Like, the room got darker because you've been playing trivia for 2.5 hours. We had a lot of rounds, but I hope you enjoyed this event. It was great that so many people turned up and donated. We are going to announce how much of the donation we get. We're going to calculate everything and actually have that announcement later on today and announce the amount of money that we created and how much we're going to be donating to each charity. But once again, thank you so very much for tuning into this. I hope you had a lot of fun. I had a lot of fun putting this together. As you can see, there was like some glitches the first round, but I started, you know, I got it moving and I made sure that everyone was covered. Once again, thank you so much. Be kind to one another. Support one another. Say thank you to the people who are doing deliveries, to the nurses, to the doctors, to everyone who's helping right now during this incredibly difficult time. It's so important right now to be kind to one another and to, you know, try to see what other people are saying and understand them, but have compassion for one another and give back to communities. I think it's so, so, so incredibly important right now to stop being angry and to have a little bit of love and care for those around you. So thank you once again for watching this. I do have the winner, though, of the big, huge package that we will be sending out, and that is Ryan Black. I am so very happy for Ryan that he got this prize pack. Probably will take a couple of weeks before I venture out to the post office to mail it. But congratulations, Ryan. Again, thank you, everyone, so very, very much. Tomorrow, we will do the final calculations of all the people who played, all the teams. And stay tuned to our Twitter page, our Facebook page. We will announce those winners on there. And that's it. You know, thank you so very much. And like I said, just be kind to one another. Say thank you to people, and just be good. All right. Stay healthy, happy. And that's it. Have a great one. Thank you so very much. Take care.